Hello Inkscape community. Today I'm going to talk about an Inkscape UI design vision I've been working on. My name is Enrique, I'm a UX designer, and you can find me in LinkedIn, Dribbble, Behance, and in my personal website here. So I think it's important to establish what are the objectives of this work I'm showing today. I want to propose UI concepts for Inkscape, and I want to start a conversation with the community to understand if this work is aligned with Inkscape goals and if the community is interested in this type of collaboration. It is also important to emphasize what this is not. This work is not a bug report or feature request or UI specs for implementation. I try to be realistic and keep my feet on the ground, so that this doesn't look a lot like an unrealistic concept, but it's something I believe it's rather workable with. So the scope of this work is to propose a consistent UI design for the panels in Inkscape and to help Inkscape adhere to industry standards. What I expect from sharing this is to get feedback and guidance from the community. I'd like to split this work into smaller and more workable sets in order to keep the discussion going with more focus by area. These are the design principles that guided me through this vision work. So first, be welcoming to new users. I plan to do that by reducing UI complexities, helping Inkscape UI adhere to industry standards, reduce context switching when performing simple tasks, and providing context-aware panels and tools. And second, to empower seasoned users. It's tempting when doing some redesign or UI design work to super simplify the existing user interface, but that comes at a cost of removing tools or features or functionalities that are very useful for power users. I plan to allow mastering complex tools and keeping the granular controls available. Okay, so let's dive in. This is the vision work. First, group tools in toolbox panel. Once you launch Inkscape, you notice there's a toolbox here in the left side. We have many different tools like selection, node, and the drawing shapes. This could be a bit overwhelming if you compare it to tools like Sketch or Figma or other emerging tools, even like Penpot. The goal here is trying to keep the tools present, revealing them through an expand button. Second thing is trying to simplify the comments bar with the two controls bar. Some of these tools are a bit redundant with the tool panel below it. For example, the copy, paste, and duplicate commands would be more relevant in context of the selection tool. Zoom or fitting windows are related to the zoom options that we have down below. And then we have open, save, print, new file, undo and redo, which are commands that are usually not displayed anymore so prominently in the UI. Usually these buttons are hidden under the file or edit menus, and that would save us some real estate in the UI. Also, these other buttons here, they serve as quick access to the panels, right? But we also have other ways to access them, like the drop-down I just showed. In my proposal, I'm trying to move the zoom options to the status bar and move these items here to the selection toolbar. In the status bar, we have the center page, fit drawing, or fit selection under the zoom menu. We also have the option to scroll up and down to increase or decrease zoom and rotation, and then we have the mouse cursor position. Also with the tooltips, which I did some minor formatting, like showing the icons and symbols for the modification keys. So if you compare the existing status bar, it also has the cursor position, the zoom level, the rotation degrees, some tooltips for the selected tools, and then we also have some redundant actions for the layers panel. To simplify this, I'm just removing this part and keeping everything else and incorporating the fitting, zoom, to the zoom portion of the status bar. So that's what you have here. If you look at the color palette, it occupies some significant space here. And because it goes on the bottom part, it takes the full width. And then we have a kind of confusing behavior that you need to scroll down to see the colors, even this being something that is displayed horizontally. So by moving it to the right side, we save some precious space here in the canvas. So I'm proposing to move the color palettes to the right side of the screen, and then keeping the pinned colors at the top, and then allowing users to scroll vertically to see the whole color palette. If you pay attention here, like in the layers panel, if you click to lock, it switches from the open locker to the closed one. And here, instead of doing the same behavior, it highlights it in blue. So I'm proposing to have the consistent behavior for the icon there. We have the selection indicators here, and they end in circles, which is not super precise to show the position where the shape starts and ends, right? So I'm proposing to use a simple line and a colored background to show the selection indication here. And also we have a bunch of lines, like black lines dividing the space. And I'm proposing to use lighter ones, or even removing some of the borders to make the UI less overwhelming. Let's show how these first five concepts combine together in the UI. So here you have the toolbar. When you click it, you see the other tools that are collapsed. We have the tabs here. I removed the commands bar and brought some of those buttons to the selection here. Then we have the color palette move it to the right panel, and it scrolls as I described it before. And then we also have the zoom controls here in the bottom status bar. Then when you click it, we have the options to center page, fit drawing, fit selections, and we could add other zoom related features here. We have also the zoom percentage and the rotation degrees here, and the mouse cursor position. Here you have the hotkeys for the tooltips. So by removing some of these bars, like the comment bar here in the top and the color palette from the bottom and other stuff, you can already see how the UI is much cleaner and more inviting to new users. Path builder. So you see how it fits in this new format. This is the pages one, and you have like the add page, the templates here, the page label, the margins, and page navigation here. And we also have one for the nodes transform tool. So here we have all the relevant features. Let's talk about the sixth item, the new object properties panel. There's an effort going on to create a new object properties panel that combines two other previous panels. And I'd like to take this a step further. To change a simple fill and stroke, I need to go to a dedicated panel with fill and stroke, and then go to the specific tabs. And look at the amount of space that this panel occupies in the UI, right? So that's one of the issues. The other one is that to manipulate the properties of a rectangle shape, I would need to come to either the properties panel. So here we have some of the options, but then again, I would need to come and go from tab to tab, or I would need to come to the rectangle tool here and then change the parameters here in the top bar. Okay, so I prepared this prototype to show the specific feature of the new object properties panel. So let's say I show this layer, and here I have some shapes, like a rectangle one. So you see now I have it selected, it shows the indication in the rulers in this new style. And then we have here in the right panel the options for this rectangle. We have, of course, these are fake values. We have the X and Y positions, width and height, rotation, radius for the corners, the option to switch by a sharp corner or a rounded one, the fill rule for non-zero or even odd. And then we have here some color options. Let's say for fill, I could click the eyedropper tool and just immediately apply the color to the shape, or I could click it and show this new color picker popover I'm working on. So the same thing for stroke. If I click on it, and because this is a gradient, I also have a new gradient editor with the stop options, the stop offset orientation, and the repeat mode. If I want to change the stroke in the same panel, I can just click it and change the width, unit, join, meter, and all other options. And let's say I want to change like the markers, I can just click it and see the popover with the marker options. And this is a simplified version of the markers panel, because if I want, I can edit this on canvas, or I could just click the advanced options here to see all the remaining options that I've hidden initially. And it would remember the state of the panel. So next time I open it, it will still be open and I can close it if I want it. If I want to reorder the markers, stroke, and fill, in Inkscape's current UI, I would need to come to the stroke style. If I want to play with the order of the elements here in the shape, I may learn from repetition and muscle memory what these icons mean, but a much simpler way would be drag and drop the order of the fills, stroke, and markers. We have also the properties panel. It has the same content as in Inkscape's current UI, and then an interactivity panel. But anyway, let's say I wanna switch to a spiral. Then you see how I don't need to switch to the spiral tool to see the related options here. We have the turns, divergence, inner radius, everything in the same panel. Same thing for a path, which is hidden by default because it could be a bit overwhelming for new users to see the path data, but you can always come in and expand and edit it. We have the ellipse with all the shape options to open the path or keep it closed, and also options for the 3D box. This object properties panel also has a simplified version of the align panel. This isn't meant to replace the existing align and distribute panel. Sometimes I use it for more advanced operations like grid distributing objects or distributing them in a radial grid. But for most of the cases, we would only need horizontal or vertical aligning. So I keep this as shortcuts for performing the most common operations here. One thing I like about this new layout for the panel is that I'm using three columns here. So on the left one, we have space for labels. And on the middle one, we have the tools parameters to be changed, and on the right one we have some additional options. For example, here I have like the link, so that if I want to change width and height at the same time, I can just enable it here. If I want to drag and drop the fill, stroke, and markers, I have this additional icon on the right side of the column. I showed a preview of the new color picker popover, and here is it in its full version. So I have versions for HSL and HSV with a color wheel. We then have one for RGB. We have all the number inputs here, and I always keep the EXA code here, and a picker, and then the option to switch the color pickers. I even included one for CMYK. I can just, let's say, if I wanna switch, change the color for the rectangle, I could come here and change another color picker option, right? Also, let's say in CMYK, I would have the sliders here. So I'm trying to simplify the panels because, for example, today in Inkscape Gradient Editor, we have some redundancies here. Like we have stops editing here. We also have stops editing here. I think it's a lot of UI being space being used to perform some simple actions. For the gradient editor, here we have the same options I showed you in Inkscape's current UI, but in a more organized and fitting way. Okay, here we have the popover for opening new panels, and then I'm proposing a new organization according to the topics or subject of each section. So we still have the basic one, but I added text and typography, which groups the text-related functions. Then we have one for assets, and then we have advanced properties and diagnostic. Ideally, I believe this last one should be hidden unless activated in the settings, because I think it's meant to be more for developers than for end users. Okay, now this one, I think it's super cool. One of my favorite features in Inkscape is the live path effects. I'm using the same grid layout I used in the new object properties panel. So I'm using the columns so that we have more readable panel contents. Let's start with the power stroke. So we have some of the options here, and this reminds me a lot of Blender's modifiers panel, right? So that's where I get my inspiration from to do the grid layout here. So here we have the path effect, and if I open the same one, let's say for power stroke, I have the labels at the left and a single column here in the right side with all the options that I can change. Again, just comparing, I think the new one provides more clarity and more readability and makes the UI more inviting to new users. So here we have an indication for drag and drop, and then we have this drop down option and a delete option here, and also a visibility option. I tried to make this simpler by hiding the drag and drop indication because it's a common pattern to drag and drop stuff in these types of panel, just like in the layers panel. And I added the delete option to this drop down menu. And for the other tools, here's just an example. Of course, these aren't applied, but we have the lattice deformation in this new layout. Let's compare it with the previous one. So this is the current one, and this is the one I'm proposing. Then we have the corners effect, which I'll show here. So this is the existing one, and this is the one I'm proposing. So the downside of having this columns layout is that it dramatically increases the height of the panel. So here you see how this is a bit shorter, and the one I'm proposing is a bit taller, right? But again, you lose in space, in vertical space here, but inside a panel that is already scrollable, right? But you gain in readability. Here we have the new grid layout with the columns, and I'm showing these four sample effects. Then I have the path effects drop down. I prepared a new layout, which is mainly a different distribution in white space and diagramming, but nothing really changes here. Well, this video is certainly longer than I expected, but I think it was possible to show all of the features and proposal I've been trying to work on. So I'm really looking forward to your feedback, and if you're interested in collaborating with me, just ping me. I'm in the Inkscape UX channel, and then we can chat about it. Thanks again for your attention, and if you want to get in touch, these are my social networks. See ya!